It's a real honor to be here, I have to say. I was really surprised when I got the letter and super pleased. It's my first time in India, and I'm really excited to be here. I've always wanted to visit. So I need to thank IIT Guwahati, Techniche 2017, and the entire organizing team who got me here. They really went the extra mile to make sure I got here and made it here safely and comfortably. So actually, I can't. Can you bring up the house lights just a little bit, real quick? House lights? Anybody? There we go. Okay, I'm gonna do a selfie real quick with you guys. And then I'm gonna ask for your help in something. All right, so now, all right, everybody raise your hand like you're gonna ask a question, okay? Hey, hold on. Okay, and now, hold on. I'm gonna count to three. Raise your hand again. Everybody raise your hand. I'm gonna count to three, and when I say three, you say, when is Half-Life 3? Okay? All right? Ready? Raise your hand. One, two, three.
When is Half-Life 3?
Awesome. Thank you. All right, you can turn down the house lights. And you can even turn down my lights a little bit, maybe make it so it's a little more bright up there. So I know that most of you are students, probably 99% of you here are students, and so I kind of put this talk together especially for you. It's called The Process is the Product, which is my theme of the talk. And the way I think of it is this. One of my great favorite teachers of all time, which was my high school film and television teacher, used to tell me this. I don't know where she got the quote. It's probably a Stan Brakhage or some avant-garde video artist who came up with this. But the idea is that the process you go through that makes the product, the art, you know, I mean, I'm an artist, that's what I do mostly, is not, the product is not a result of the process, it is the process. And the best example I can think of is a cook, right? Someone who's gonna make you dinner. When they start out, they have an idea in their mind of what your experience is going to be like when you eat, right? So already the product isn't what you normally think of. When you're thinking of a cook is going to make dinner, it's going to be an object that sits on a plate, and you look at it, maybe it's pretty, it smells good, but really the end goal is the eating of the food, right? So already you've got the process starts all the way back in the cook's mind and ends when you consume the food. And everything in between is one thing. It's not two separate things. It's not the process and the product. The process is the product. The entire, from this end to that end, is the product. And as you know, like some people cook with a recipe, right? So there's a structure. Some people make it up as they go. So already there's choice there that can happen that can completely influence what's going to come out the back end based on the front end. And then let's say you are using a recipe. People have choices like, you know, exactly what is a tablespoon of salt? You know, some people a little more, some people a little less. Maybe they do it with their fingers because they have their own sense of what that means to put some salt in there. So even though you have a structure, a recipe, that person is going to make a different dish than somebody else. And then you have the intangible process, the hidden secret process, which is, I don't know if you've seen, there's a movie called like Water for Chocolate. And it's all about the love that is felt while you cook, right? And of course, you could probably break that down so that it's like if somebody's loving the people they're cooking for, they're going to pay more attention to the food and the way it tastes and make it extra good. But maybe it's all these intangible, lots of little details and complex data that actually makes up that dish. And then, of course, the setting and the way it's served. And then, are you hungry? That's a famous French quote, like hunger makes the best sauce. So if you're really hungry, oh, it's gonna taste so good. And if you're in love with the cook, all the better, right? So that's the idea, is that it's one continuum. Let's see. So this is something I like to think about sometimes, and this is sort of a look at process. So over here on the left, you have the beginning, and you know the completion is your blue line, how much you've gotten done, and the yellow are the possibilities of what you can do. So at the beginning, you haven't gotten anything done, zero done, and everything's possible, right? There's nothing that's not possible at that point because you haven't done anything. You haven't eliminated any possibilities in the process. But as you go, in this case, it's a linear inverse, right? Like, as you go, more things get done, less things become possible, and by the end, you have the thing, which is kind of like something, but it's actually the thing. It's the end, and nothing's possible. Well, everything's completed, but nothing else is possible, right? That's sort of the way I like to think about it. So over here, you've got the beginning, and over there, you've got the end, and this is the entire, it's the process and the product. Now, this is a really unlikely setup for how you're going to create something, right? This is way more likely because you're students and you don't know any better. And I would do the same thing too, which is, you know, I'm going to procrastinate for as long as possible, like sleep late and, you know, not do anything, really. And then I'm going to get really nervous right about there, but not nervous enough to do anything. And then I go, oh my God, if I don't, it's already too late. If I don't start now, I really have no choice but to fail. And then you do everything right at the end, right? There is a positive way to look at this, though, which is over here, maybe you're sleeping a lot and participating in alpha dreams, right? Dreams where you wake up and you go back to sleep and you dream all kinds of weird shit and it makes like really cool thoughts. Or you're consuming a lot of music, in my case, or really thinking about the product a lot. And then you get it all done at the end. The sort of for big projects, the healthier thing and probably the better thing is to do it like this, which is you get 90% of everything done up front. Because let's say you're doing, 120 pieces of music for a video game or 200 shots for a film. If you do this left part first, what you're doing is you're getting rid of risk. You're trying to get all your work done to a degree of quality that is maybe acceptable, maybe not. You make mental notes of what's acceptable, what isn't. And then you spend the rest of the time iterating over everything because you've identified all the risks. Like if you take all your time to the end and you like suddenly discover, oh, there's this thing over here that I have no idea how to do. I just wasted all my time and now I don't have time to finish. And you fail. And failing is never a good thing in the arts. I mean, when you're young, it is. Like, now is a great time to fail because you're young. But this is a much more reasonable way to do it, is to get... But anyway, this is a way to look at process that I do like, and I think it's useful, and it's a useful thing to communicate. The linear opposite for what's possible and what isn't is totally a fabrication. Sometimes they're completely non-linear, not exact inverse of each other, but it's a useful way to kind of look at it. All right, so I know you're students, and you're mostly engineering students, from what I understand, and so there's no reason to assume that you know anything about animation or anything about music, which are two of the big things I'm going to talk about. I'll talk about programming a little bit, too, which you probably know more about. So I'm gonna go for breadth. I'm going to cover as much stuff as I possibly can, so I'm going to talk a lot really fast. And I'm not going to go very deep. There's a couple things I will go deeper into, and I'll do my best to kind of explain it to you in a way that I make games, and one of the things that we're really good at is, well, if it's done right, is training you slowly but surely so you don't get frustrated, you don't get lost, right, in the game. And so that's what I'm hoping to do here. I'm just going to kind of try and help you understand and see. So one of the things that I've seen since I've been here, and people, especially students, ask me about is, because I'm very cross-disciplined, I work in a lot of different fields, and hopefully through the process of explaining the breadth of my career, you'll understand that there's actually some really clear threads there, and it's not as surprising or unique or special as it might seem. Which brings me to my story. I don't really like to talk about myself that much. I much prefer to talk about my art, which I do really like to talk about. But it was expressed that, you know, you're students, and so you probably really want to know how I got where I am. So again, what I'm going to do is I'm going to lay out my story, and complete with all the disciplines. Not all. It's going to be, in fact, a small fraction, but the ones that I'm known for and that you would find interesting, because otherwise we'll just be talking about me the whole time. And then I'm going to iterate over that story across the different media types that I'm talking about and kind of cover two different things. One is the mechanics of production. So cooking, right? You're going to have a process that's going to involve probably preparing your vegetables, and then you're going to have some kind of heat thing where you warm things up and some spices, right? This is sort of the process component. And production, what I mean by production, that's sort of industry term for getting from nothing to something when the heat is on, when it's time. Like you're actually in production. In film, it means when they start shooting, right? Everything before that is pre-production. For the case of this conversation, I'm going to call everything production. But the idea is when you're producing stuff. And then I'm going to go back and go over it again, but this time talk about the complexity of performances versus authored content, right? Like, we'll cover it more later, but it's sort of in the cooking context, it's like authored is something, is the recipe. It's something somebody sits down and meticulously kind of figures out. Performances like music, like you playing the guitar or singing, and the differences between those two, and how they kind of, how things can get in the way. They can filter those, the communication of that data from the author to the consumer, and then what that means in the context of new mediums and the resolution through which it's being communicated. Like right now, if I were to sing, which I might do a little later, but I'm not that great at it, but either way, it's going through this crappy microphone, and then it's going to come out these speakers, and so you're not actually getting the thing that I'm giving you. You're getting a filtered version of it, right? So that's sort of what that's about. And new mediums always have a greater filter, so we'll talk about that a little bit. And then consumption, again, if you're sitting at the table, where are you eating? Are you like at a picnic somewhere? Consumption really is a big part of it, and I'll cover that briefly at the end. And then I'm going to talk about going forward in regards to these topics, process and those two components of three components of process. And we're going to talk about machine learning a little bit because it's the big hype right now, and it is super powerful. But I think in the context of these things, there are some things to think about when you think about using machine learning for anything. The convergence of games and linear media. Throughout this thing, I'm going to go back and forth between the term linear media and film. But linear media means something that isn't interactive. So video, YouTube, film, you know, Twitch, for that matter. Although Twitch is kind of oddly interactive, I guess. So the convergence of those two things, which we're seeing. And then new mediums that are likely to come up, or what people are talking about. And again, this is all in the context of process. All right, now about me. I've spent my whole life in the arts. When I was a kid, I didn't want to be an astronaut. I didn't really want to be a fireman or any of those kinds of things. I wanted to be a novelist, I think, was the first thing. A comic book artist, a magician. I was really into that for a while. All kinds of stuff, but they were all basically around the arts. And so it's sort of how I've spent my life. I've always been pretty obsessed with process. A lot of times people will call me a technical artist, and that's not untrue, but I'm also on the one hand, I'm really obsessed with the process of production and the techniques and the technical components of that. I'm also really obsessed with that actorly version too, which is the undefinable sort of hidden process that goes on. And the truth is all art throughout all history has been, other than singing is a special one, has been connected to some form of technology, whether it was, you know, crushing pigments to make your paint, that's technology, right? Guitar or violin, any step or progress in technology has always superseded or preceded new forms of art without fail. So I started young. I'm not by any means a prodigy or anything. I just happened to be really interested in the arts really young. Oh, and here's the other thing. You guys are all, I assume most of you, are, I guess, what we call digital natives, right? So you would have had the internet pretty much your whole life. I am not, by any stretch. I'm 53 years old, so I pretty much grew up in the late 60s, 70s. And while there were computers and I was exposed to them, they weren't a part of my life to any really strong degree until probably the mid-80s. However, so our generation, I think Brooks is a similar age, we're sort of one generation under the Bill Gateses and, you know, the Bill Wozniaks and whatnot who invented computers. So we're almost kind of generation zero when it comes to computers and art. Like, I have had access to computers when they made a big difference to how I did my art and how I was able to accomplish my art. And so I think by going through this life story, you'll get to a little bit of a history, you know, not a deep one, but a little bit of a history lesson that you otherwise probably wouldn't be familiar with. I think there's a really big difference between the fact that you have probably had a smartphone for a lot of years and what those applications mean versus those of us who, you know, would run an application with a command line and it would take 5 minutes to load up, right? That was a really different era and it had a really different meaning to the process of art early on. So the thing I'm gonna focus on is temporal arts, which is what I do for the most part. I do draw, but I'm not very good at it and it's not really what I focus on. By temporal arts, I mean the design of things that happen over time, right? Like even story in film is a temporal art because you're basically communicating symbols or events over time that add up to a story or an idea. Music is clearly temporal art. I don't mean Jackson Pollock, who is temporal while he's making his art. You know, he's throwing the paint down and splashing it around and kicking it or whatever. Because at the end of the day, he's making a static painting. And yes, the consumption of that painting is a time you're consuming it through time, but it wasn't designed, like the moments of time that you consume it, while through his symmetry or whatever, he might have guided you loosely, it's not a time-based form, right? So that's what I've focused on my whole life and what we're gonna talk about pretty much today, if you kind of include programming in that. Art versus craft and science. This is something that I've thought about quite a bit. I don't know, because I think too much. That's not what I wanted to do. The way I personally define art versus craft, and I know it's the classic, like, what is art, you know? But for me, the gist of art is it's an expression of a person. It's a person trying to be unique. It's trying to say, I am a unique being in the universe. Here's my art. They don't have to think that, but that's sort of the gist of it. Whereas craft is the technique, the process you use to achieve the ends, the artistic outcome, right? They're not mutually exclusive. A lot of times, most times, art is going to use some form of craft to achieve its end. But you can have craft that is devoid of art, right? Like, it's entirely possible. Commercial art is often that case, I think. Sometimes my work is somewhere in between, because my craft is actually coming first. I'm trying to design a product that achieves an end. But at the same time, I'll often sneak my own art in there, or I'll find a way to make the craft of what I'm doing artistic. So it's me as a unique individual in the universe expressing something through a commercial form. And now science is an interesting one because I think that can fit in that continuum as well. I don't know if you saw Nadrian Seaman's talk yesterday. That to me was total art, and that it doesn't get any more science either. That was some heavy science, but I think that there is a continuum all the way over there. I use science, and it has a process which is a little more dictated, I think, than art, for example. But I think those three can all sort of co-mingle amongst themselves. For the most part today, though, I'm going to talk about craft. I'll talk a little bit about art in that second section, but that's sort of... All right, so I already covered Generation Zero. All right, and so this is sort of an interesting one. With the craft component and the production component, the thing that time, like, the idea of, well, I'll get to that in a second. With time, as a student, you're going to need to, like, study really specific things and become expert at something at some point in your life, because that's a really important thing to do, to be expert at something, right? If you're going to cross disciplines, however, you also, like, kind of have to be able to step back and look at the bigger picture. And when you do that, particularly in production, art production, you know, you're optimizing for quality. Learning to optimize for quality is super important, because if you don't have quality, nobody's going to like your art, right, at the end of the day. And it's not that hard of a thing to learn, but you have to go through a lot of failure to get there. But then again, sometimes you got to optimize for quantity, because if you're doing, say, 200 shots for a film and you don't get three of them done, all the other quality is not going to make up for the quantity that you're missing. And then again, the secret hidden process is something that I do really believe in, which is it's that feeling that you imbue in your art that is sort of undefinable, but I'll get to that in a little bit. Okay, so this is a really famous overused quote, but it's still a great one. Arthur C. Clarke: any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable but from magic. The way I read that to mean is, because our minds search for meaning in things, when we don't understand something, if there's a technology so advanced that we can't comprehend possibly how it's done, we assign something to it, like magic or mysticism. When really it is, we just don't understand the technology involved. And I, because it's Arthur C. Clarke, I assume what he's saying is that to get rid of magic, we need to understand. Have I really been going for 43 minutes? That can't be right. Anyway, so we can't. We need to sort of get rid of magic by understanding things. And then the other one is, philosophy will clip an angel's wings, conquer all mysteries by rule and line, unweave a rainbow, which is John Keats talking about Newton, who basically, I guess, unwove the rainbow. And rainbows are beautiful, and they're meant to be magical. And I think magic is a useful thing in the world, and that's where that hidden process comes in. So you don't want to understand things too well. All right, so my father was a professor. He used to bring home technology all the time. A lot of this stuff, this is a video camera that recorded reel-to-reel. My brother and I would play with them, but we were not particularly adept at art. So, and the preschool, or not preschool, sorry, the elementary school I went to had a television studio that we would go and play Star Trek in. Again, didn't really make much use of it. But the 8mm film camera I really did make use of, and really got into doing stop-motion animation, which is you take shots of something and move it around and take another shot, take another shot, take another shot, and at the end you have animation, which you see with the Leica films like Coraline and Kubo, the two strings. And I really got into that, as well as hand-drawn animation. I wasn't particularly good at it, but I found it really interesting. I was not a prodigy. My parents got me a guitar when I was 7, and I immediately tuned it up too high and then broke the neck. And then sat there and went boing, 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 right? And just thought it was the funnest thing. And I still had that guitar later when I made records and used it on a record. But they got me drum set, piano, and the thing I found is that I really didn't have, at that age anyway, enough discipline to really study. And what I really wanted to do was write, but nobody was kind of figuring that out and helping me along with it. All right, so let's see if this works. You know, I'm old enough that my first video game was Pong when it originally came out. I should figure out video now. Right? And man, I just thought it was the greatest thing ever. I just was like super into it. Of course, then Atari later came out with a console that had cartridges, and I think with Donkey Kong or something was a big success, but then they put out a whole bunch of terrible games. And this one has some issues with it too, but we'll talk about that in a minute. My dad was a professor, had access to computers like 1970, 1971. He would take me in and dial it up in a modem thing and bring up pictures of the planets in their actual position at that actual day, and I'd just be like, oh my God, that's so cool. And then I'd be like, can I make a move? No, because he'd say, well, we can update it to right now, push a button, and 10 minutes later, the screen would come back up. It was really early computing. I thought of them mostly as toys. We got a Commodore, was it a VIC-20, I think, later, and I programmed a text-only maze game. Really bad idea, but you know, I got really into that. Again, I really thought of it though, this is like, you know, 1979, 1980 at the latest, and so there was no there really, you know, that it was just kind of a toy that I was interested in. And then in high school we had a statistics class that they also had computers, and they taught us Fortran, and I was really interested there too. In fact, to the point where I was like, oh man, if I got out of school, I could make, you know, go make $10,000 a year, and that'd be cool. And then I was like, ah, but then I'd have the green bill and be an accountant, and I didn't want to. And so, which leads me to bands. I picked up the guitar for real around about that same time, 13, 14, and just like fell in love. The instant gratification of playing music and entertaining people on stage really, really spoke to me. So then right after high school, I mean, I played in bands all through high school. Before I was out of high school, I was playing professionally in a bar, you know, 5 nights a week, 4 hours a night, 15-minute breaks. You know, your hands are bloody at the end of the night. But I really kind of learned my chops and how to function in that environment and to entertain people who, you know, I don't know if you've seen the Blues Brothers, but I played behind chicken wire, people throwing bottles at it, the whole nine yards. But I traveled to Japan. I lived in Tokyo for 2 years, and this was a really important time for me because I explored all of these things. It was a really interesting time. Laurie Anderson was really big. Japan was crazy. They had giant billboards with Joseph Beuys. I don't know if you know who he is. He's a conceptual artist from Germany. And they were really into kind of out there art, way more than I'd seen in the U.S. And everybody was kind of going nuts for all kinds of stuff. It's the first place I got a computer that you could do art with. I programmed an animation program, then did animation and did avant-garde performance video art. I did composing for some commercial interests. Did some work with Ryuichi Sakamoto, which is pretty amazing in retrospect. I was, you know, 19, and did, you know, got into all those things. Some film directing, which was really interesting. By way of, I did that, and then I finally decided it was time to come back to the States and got back into bands. And at that time, it was the mid-80s, and punk rock and really loud, angry, aggressive music was really happening. But more importantly, the DIY, which means do-it-yourself scene, was really blossoming, and I got really into that and made lots of records, you know, toured the world many times over, the United States dozens of times, and really learned about the process of making something from nothing and selling it and making a living from that, and then dealing with your customers, I hate saying that, but your audience and the people, the fans that are paying for you. In that period, I was in the studio a lot and got hired by this company, Euphonics, who make big kind of high-end studio recording consoles, and was their first outside programmer. I learned to program parallel distributed embedded systems, which is, you know, it's basically assembly language coding that you put on a chip and then you put the chip in the console. And I'll talk about that in a second, but it was definitely an experience in really deep, large code base programming and kind of deep programming, and it paid the bills pretty well. And then I got a job at this company called Protozoa, which I won't go into too much, but it was a real-time animation company in San Francisco that came out of a company called Colossal Pictures. Colossal Pictures was, I don't know if you guys know MTV. MTV was a station that just played music videos once upon a time, and then eventually they started doing these short animated bits, a thing called Liquid Television, and this company came out of that, and we did real-time animation. Had a good run, 5 or 6 years. I worked with a young guy named Bay Rate, who was, you know, 4 or 5 years younger than me. Well, I think he's somewhere in that ballpark. Best digital modeler I've ever known, and we'll talk about him. He made this character here. But it was real-time performance animation. So I don't know if you know what motion capture is, but this is motion capture rig using electromagnets. So there's a giant orb or a box that makes a magnetic field, and then you attach these magnetic sensors to your feet, your hands, your elbows, your knees, your waist, your chest, and your head. And it outputs 3D position and orientation coordinates that then can be read in and drive a puppet in the computer. As you can see, it has a giant bundle of wires, and we'd wear a heads-up display like VR, but you would use it to see what your puppet's doing. So it wasn't inside out, because you can't see what that is. It was more like a camera back at it. To run this, we were using the Silicon Graphics Onyx machine, which is the size of a small refrigerator, and cost about $250,000, right? So this is early. It's like 1995, as you know, more than 20 years ago, but that's what it took. This is an example of some performance animation. You can see this is a human, right? So there are the sensors, the hands, the elbows, the head, the neck, you know, the feet. And this puppet is set up such that hand controls the head, that hand controls the hand, and these 2 feet control the stomach, right? So you can kind of do a worm like that. It was a weird company, but pretty cool work was getting done there. This is a good example of there are all the sensors coming off of the thing and then mapped to the different size puppets. All right, here's an interesting example I'll set up here real quick. This is probably, I don't know, 500 polygons at the most. You'll notice this is a very early web browser, and I'll get into why that is in a minute, but I excuse the video quality. This stuff comes from a long time ago, and it's tough to, whoops. Can I do this? Nope, I guess not. Hold on. I'm not sure what that was, but let's see.
Oh my gosh! Look at that!
Holy Mother of God!
So we were doing some pretty funny, weird stuff. I was there for 5 years and directed multiple projects, animated a ton of them, was animation director on a whole bunch of them. And by the end, it was kind of the dot-com boom. We created our own station, which was called Dot Comics, which you couldn't, like downloading a QuickTime video, like a few minutes would take like 20 minutes. So YouTube was out. That was not, that kind of thing wasn't happening. So what we'd do is you'd download the geometry, and then you'd download the animation data and the sound, right? And so it made it possible to watch cartoons. But I also, I met this guy, Bay Rate, who went on to New Zealand and called me and was like, dude, you gotta come down here. There's this project going on. It's really interesting. This guy, Peter Jackson, is making Lord of the Rings. And I was like, no, I don't think so. That sounds like a bad idea. I've seen his movies. They're not very good. And then I talked to them and said, okay, that sounds a good idea, actually. I went down there, and I was there, you know, a full, like, year before actual, like, they were doing filming production, but post-production, the CG part, was still in pre-production. So pre for post. This is us at the set for Minas Tirith, which was, you know, an amazing, amazing set, incredible construction. I was there when there really weren't very many people at Weta Digital, and participated in sort of the setup for a lot of it. Here we can watch real quick. I was on a team called the Massive Team. We were doing AI-based animation, which I'll show you. These people up front are film. The background is mostly probably CG or miniature sets. And then all the humans in the far background are actually CG. Let me see if I can. All right, so you can see all this stuff back here. That's all our team. You can see all that stuff, all these guys. In fact, all of this is CG, and it's all Massive, which is a software program written by Stephen Regulus, a really clever system. All those guys, all that. You can see there's guys working and whatnot. I showed up early. You know, my job was all kinds of stuff. I worked with Peter Jackson looking at the storyboards, breaking down the shots. We did pre-production for all three films up front, identified all the motion capture, worked with the stunt team and the sword master to figure out how all the different character types would behave and how they would fight with what weapons, and then how to break them down into a motion tree and use that motion tree then to drive animation. You can see here. Now, there's also something else that happened in this process. This is the fellowship right there. Because I had done so much motion capture and directed so much motion capture, I was also, and here they are again, I was also tasked with directing the fellowship, like Sir Ian McKellen and Billy Boyd and whatnot. And so that was Sean Bean. That was really particularly interesting. And so I spent a lot of time with those guys. I was on a team, though. You know, I was one of the senior guys. But there was a team of us, and we all worked really long, long days. There I am with Billy Boyd, who's Pippin. So there you got that. Can't tell where the timer is, but anyway. So I came home. I was there for 2 years. I did the pre-production on all three films, which is why I'm credited with all three films, and then worked through the first film. And at the end of that, my wife got pregnant, and we decided to come back to the United States to have our daughter there. Because I thought I would work too hard if I was in New Zealand, still working on a film. A big film like that. Instead, I came back and worked too hard in the United States. Whoops, on the Matrix. Matrix sequels. I got to clarify. It was Reloaded and Revolutions, and I was hired ostensibly to go in and do something similar to what we had done on Lord of the Rings, use AI sort of architecture to animate the sentinels in a big swarm for the siege team. I was on this team with a group of guys, and the siege is where all the sentinels come down and break into the big dome and slaughter everybody. And when they explained to me the number of shots, how many sentinels they wanted to do, and how they wanted to shoot it, which is funny because both Peter Jackson and the Wachowskis would describe it like this. Well, we want like a natural battle to be just happening, and we want to be there like we're documenting it, you know? Which is, of course, not true, because the second you do something like that, they're like, they get their camera, they're like, can we get these guys over there? And they actually want to compose the shot. But when they described the amount of work they wanted done, I said, so that's impossible. We can't, it's no way we can do that. And they said, okay, start tomorrow. Here's a quick sequence from that, and you'll see a bunch of this. So, yeah. All of those sentinels have their own brains, we call them, their own little programs that run. And I'll get into that a little bit more, a little further on. It was quite a project and really fascinating and a lot of work. And then after that, I left ESC and kind of went to work for various studios, freelance, doing everything from CG supervising to just piecework. Like, usually they'd find some difficult problem that nobody else could solve and hand it to me. And I'd do some compositing and other bigger endeavors. And this is Matthew Barney's drawing Restraint 9, which is a total art film, but really had some interesting visual effects in it. So I was doing that, and I was kind of adrift. I was free, what we call film gypsy. I was going from film job to film job, and not unhappy, but also seeing that a lot of work was going overseas, and kind of seeing that being hands-on was gonna not actually work after a while, and I was gonna have to become in charge, which I wasn't, you know, I wasn't that excited about. And then this happened. I went to see one of those films. I can't remember honestly which one it was. I think it was probably Pirates of the Caribbean. And beforehand, I saw this trailer. Oops. Oh, this keeps, let's see.
Oh, who else squish came to hide, or is this just some pheromone thing that's kicking in?
Pheromones are scents that are given off by the female that create that original attraction.
Of course it's all chemical to start with. The true love is incredible.
But is it rooted in physiology rather than our hearts?
I'm kind of attracted to her.
It doesn't make any sense.
Why does it have to make sense?
You slept together?
It was before we were dating.
You're dating?
Sort of.
Sort of's a good description. I just thought we had something that night. I didn't think it'd end up...
You're the one who doesn't believe in that feeling thing. Why me, Rand? What makes me special?
So I was at the theater, and this trailer comes up, and I was like, God, that sounds really familiar. And I realized that a friend of mine who had scored this film had gotten me to come in and play a bunch of guitar like months and months earlier. And all that music in there, the guitar, is me. And I was so just like, oh my God, that's the coolest thing ever. And that's when I thought, hey, maybe that's what I should be doing next. And so I let my friend Bay, who I told you about. Oh, Bay, by the way, is the one who got me down to New Zealand. He designed and modeled the whole system that ran Gollum's face, right? So he animated a bunch of Gollum and put that whole system together. One of the brightest guys I know, still today, for sure. And so I called him. I was like, dude, I want to do music. I want to do music for film. And he said, dude, I'm in Seattle. There's this company up here. And they make video games that are amazing, and they've got this new platform how they're going to distribute games. I was like, oh, I don't want to move to Seattle. Like, I don't know. And he said, well, you got to come up and meet these guys at Valve. And so now, at that time, Valve was known primarily for Half-Life, Counter-Strike, Team Fortress. Classic, Day of Defeat, of course, Half-Life 2, which is still kind of one of the best games of all time, and Steam, which was a new platform, which I was super interested in. I was like, wait a minute, you mean you can shove like data to people and, you know, update your content? And so I went up and visited, and saw the team that Bay was working on. They were building this thing called the Source Filmmaker, which is basically, I'll get into it a little more later, but it's basically using a game as an editing and performance system to make film and video, linear content. Is this the one that we'll play now? Basically, what it does is, you can see here, we made a ton of videos with it. You know, in a traditional editing suite, you would actually have film and cut the film, whereas this is a live game, and when you do a cut, you're just changing the camera angle, right? And animation will automatically update itself and whatnot. But anyway, I went up and visited these guys. They were doing really cool stuff. And at first, they wanted me to be an animator or director. And I was like, no, I've changed over to music. And a year kind of went by of back and forth and working on various projects that haven't actually come out. And eventually they said, okay. And then I said, I don't know. And eventually then I went up and started working with them full time. And from then, I pretty much worked on every game after. Sometimes composing all the music, sometimes composing some of the music, sometimes just making myself useful, sometimes, you know, just testing the game. But there's just been a bunch of them ever since. And then now as we expand into other things, I really do just try, like, you know, Steam VR, I just try to make myself useful if I can, but we have whole teams that are kind of taking care of that stuff. And as we get into hardware, which is interesting, and I do have a background in, I'm always, you know, kind of looking at what can I do to help and what's the next thing there. Okay, does anybody have idea? My computer doesn't seem to be telling me the proper time. How long has it been? Anybody know? Huh? All right, well, I'm just going to go. You're going to have to stop me. All right, so mechanics of production. The idea here is it's like a, if I'm going to tell you how to cook Italian, I'm not going to give you like a tablespoon of this and a this of that. I'm not going to give you a recipe. I'm going to say Italians cut up a bunch of garlic. They heat up a bunch of olive oil. They put the garlic in. They might put some carrots. They might put some celery, right? I'm going to kind of walk through the process. There's always going to be a bunch of tomatoes, probably, pasta, inevitably. I'm going to give you the general layout of how Italians cook. I'm not going to give you a recipe. If you want to cook, then I'll give you the recipe, and then you can learn all the individual elements of how that works. So going through production, I explained, everything we make in life, including science, has a process. And that process can be broken down into a way that people who don't know that process can understand, and then can, through that breakdown, can look at the individual elements and understand, like, oh, I need some expertise here to be able to do this thing, or I need somebody to fill that expertise. And I think, you know, you can apply that probably to science as well. Some processes can be automated, which is an interesting thing, and some inputs to the processes can be improved. And I'll get into that a little more here in a second, but automation is often what we view as an advance in the technology itself or the art form, right? And I will explain that further. A process usually has some kind of input, like let's say, you know, if you're shooting some animation, the input would probably be the drawings. The camera is the process of shooting it, and the output would be the film that has the frames that have resulted from that shooting, right? And then that output can then be input into some other process as a way to think about it. Like I said, they can be recorded. The camera records a frame. In the case of, let's say, video, it might be just passing through into something else. It would be dynamic in that case. And then processes can contain other processes. It's basically just a node-based system for talking about these sorts of problems. And then, of course, there's the final output and how it's consumed. All right, now, this one, which we, Pong is a computer game. Oh, wait, actually, I don't want to do that here. I'm gonna do that on the next one. It's just code, right? And code is a pretty basic thing. Over here, you've got your documents are your code. You run it through compilation, assembly, linking, and then you've got an executable as your output. It's a really, right? So there you go. This square is the process. Here's your document, which is your input, and this is your final output. I'm not going to go into the code component because otherwise we could talk about this single thing for the rest of however many minutes I have. But you know, this can be automated. And we are seeing that they're using deep nets now to write code, which is an interesting thing. But this is the more likely thing. This, once upon a time, you would run the compilation by hand. You would do the assembly by hand, and you would link it all together by hand. Whereas now, you know, you just hit a button and it all happens. All right, so we're going to talk really quickly about animation just because it sets us up for the rest of it. And I'm not going to assume any of you know anything about animation. I'm sure some of you think this is super boring, but you're just going to have to bear with me because I'm doing it like soup to nuts for anybody who doesn't know. So let's say you're shooting a film. You're going to use a camera. You're going to end up with a bunch of frames. You're going to sequence those frames, which is post-production. That means editing, compositing. Compositing is taking multiple images and overlaying them to create one image that might have CG in the background, who knows. You'll do color correction, color timing. You're going to conform the audio to it, and then at the end, you've got a movie. Okay. If this is animation, you're going to do key animation, which is basically Okay, so let's say I'm walking. You would do a key like this. You would probably do a key like that. Do a key like this. In betweening is drawing all the different steps in between, right? And that's this used to be done all by hand by the artists themselves. And then I think what they did is, the way they automated the in-betweening and the coloring, so it's all done in pencil, probably then pen, and then they color. The way they automated these two things, the rest of this, by the way, is still this is the same as the other one, right? But these two things, which took a lot of time, the way they automated it was by shipping it most likely to the Philippines. I borrowed this very dystopian image from Banksy and automated it by having a bunch of people do the in-betweening and the coloring, which still is often the case today. They still will get factories in the Philippines and elsewhere, probably some here in India, to do all the work. But there is a lot of software now that will handle those components for you. Music, the process is going to look like this. This is just linear music. You've got a guitar that gets recorded. So again, I'm not telling you about this part over here. There's no how you play the guitar, how you set up the microphones, any of that stuff. It's just you have a guitar track, you have a bass track, drums, vocals. They're all run through a mixer, which is that console, which it's a...
Sir, we're running short of time, sir. If you can wrap it up quickly, then we'll take a couple of questions and end it.
Okay. anyway, so this is all... Yeah, it's all put together. There's a console. You can do this for all of these different systems. Computer graphics has the automation of the in-betweening that I talked about earlier was geometry and materials run through rigging, which moves the puppet around, and you have the in-between there. This is actually performance. Which is that?
Are you running for president?
Larry, you heard it right here. Yeah, I am running, Larry, and I want to shake things up in Washington. I want to be the ferret in the pants of government. And I'm announcing it right here because this is, let's face it, ground zero for American politics. You are where the rubber meets the road, big guy.
So that's like real-time output live over satellite with CNN in the mid-90s. These systems, instead of automating these things, we automated the actual animation itself through using fuzzy logic and AI systems that way, which are expert systems, basically hand-designed, tens of thousands of nodes of fuzzy logic designed to sense the world around you. And the way that kind of looks here is per agent, that's per person that's running around on the ground, it's going to sense the world. It's a virtual world, so it's not like robotics where you need cameras or those sorts of things. It's actually just looking around in the actual definition of the space. Process those senses. Choose the motion from a motion tree, whether it's walking or not. Procedurally adjust that animation and then do that for each and every character, and they're going to sense each other and avoid each other. It's a really complex system, but it achieves the goal at hand. Same thing here for the swarm. The biggest difference is that the sensing of the world sends its data directly over to the procedural adjustment because they're flying, and it's mostly procedural animation there. So AI behavior has emergent behavior, which is each agent has its own brain, which functions against each other. And as a group, they create a behavior. They can see, they can sense the ground, they can find navigation meshes, they can sense each other and motion. Massive is a pure fuzzy logic system, tens of thousands of nodes. The swarm system is more of an expression-based system, but it uses the same ideas. They're both expert systems. Massive uses motion capture and motion trees, whereas the swarm uses procedural animation. I don't need to talk about that much. Yeah, there's that. Okay, so doing music, it's just like the previous thing, but you've got dialogue, sound effects, Foley, music. Mix controls are automated. Here you see this the bit for the Team Fortress 2, Meet the Medic. Hundreds, that's probably a quarter of all the channel. Had probably 150 channels going. We'll watch this real quick. I'm running out of time. Apparently I talk too much. And then we can ask some questions, because I'm sure you guys have a lot of questions.
Move, Psychop, move! Come on, almost.
When the patient woke up, his skeleton was missing, and the doctor was never heard from again! Anyway, that's how I lost my medical license. Archimedes!
No!
It's filthy in there. Ugh. Birds. Now, most hearts couldn't withstand this voltage. But I'm fairly certain your heart...
What was noise?
The sound of progress, my friend. Perfect.
Kill me later.
Where was I?
There we go. Come on. Come on.
Oh, that looks good. Very nice there.
Should I be awake for this?
Then no. But as long as you are, could you hold your ribcage open a bit? I can't seem... Ah! Oh, don't be such a baby. Ribs grow back.
No, they don't.
What happens now?
Now? Let's go practice medicine.
Actually, real quick, I'm going to cover just this section because I know some people are going to be slightly interested in this. So making music, you've got the four tenets, and you've got themes, motif, ambience, action. These are sort of more meta ideas that go into making music. Linear music, I won't go into that too much. Nonlinear, so a game engine, this is sort of the system I described earlier, but if you've got a player controlling your camera and the simulation code, all of a sudden you've got a game engine, you add audio to that, and that's what that looks like. So running audio in a game engine, you've got code that triggers like footsteps and sound effects and gunfire and controls the mix and summing, the console board I was talking about, and then the music fits all into that and it goes out. So it's the same as recording music and anything else, it's just being run by code at runtime. If we look at the music component, here you've got your themes, motifs, ambience, and action, but it's now being run by game code. And there's a bunch of different ways that can happen, and would take even longer than how much time I've overtaken now to fully talk about. But here, if you listen in Left 4 Dead, the way Left 4 Dead... There's dozens of those little snippets that happen in the game, and they represent the gameplay and the game state, and they're played at not random, but with a kind of AI control mechanism. So the whole thing kind of makes a music, but also tells you what's happening in the game. There's no agents in a system like that. There is emergent behavior. Somebody could probably write something that has each piece of music is its own agent, but that'd be a little weird. I mean, I'm sure it's a cool way to do it. Hello? There it is. It is emergent. It senses the world or the game state, just like the agents in Lord of the Rings and in the Swarm stuff in The Matrix. Processes the world, chooses which cues to play, and plays procedurally adjusts and plays the music. It's an expert system as well, as opposed to something like a machine learning. Fuzzy logic is really useful for this kind of thing because it's not brittle logic. It's not if this, then that. The data that's coming through is adjusted, and so it'll adjust volumes and actually gently move between states, which is super useful for animation and music. Here's one other example from Portal 2, which is easier to... Left 4 Dead, you really literally have to play the game to hear the music, whereas in Portal 2, it's more clear. In that example, Portal 2 was an interesting problem. I can kind of skip over that. I'll wrap this up real quick. Linear versus nonlinear output. In film, you're making frames, so everybody kind of contributes to this factory line, and the end goal is the frame. Whereas in games, you're making a program, so you're using something like Perforce, and everybody's contributing to this monolithic model. And it really is a very different process. I'm not going to run through this quick review because I think we're out of time. And I have a whole other section that I'm just going to skip. But I think you can see by kind of laying it out like that, you get an idea that, you know, automating music is actually just like making music in the studio. It's just you're applying a computer program or process to do that. Same goes for the animation of the characters in Lord of the Rings. And so there is really a throughput there or a thread, I should say, on how that stuff is done and how you think about it. And usually I say like, oh yeah, we made these agents, and people love to talk in that abstract way where it's like they have brains and they run around and they avoid each other and then they fight, and that's a super cool thing to talk about, but it doesn't really help you understand what's at play there. Really all we're doing is automating the choosing of pieces of motion capture, throwing them together, procedurally adjusting the character to move around on the train. Same goes for music. Of course, like I said, the hidden process of making it creative and having the the beauty component come through, the complex data that's interesting and makes people feel something, is like a whole nother kind of the expert side of this. But by laying it out and thinking about anything this way, like what is the process, what's the recipe, what's the, not even the recipe, but what's the structure of the recipe, you can communicate anything. And so people in your mechanics, you know, mechanical engineering can talk to people over in your programming, and people in your art can talk to people in, I don't know, what else have you got here, chemistry, right? And if you can kind of think about things that way, then all of a sudden everybody can talk to each other and more or less understand what each other is doing. So with that, I'm going to go ahead and call it, because I guess we're running out of time. I think we started late as well. If anybody has any questions, I'd be happy to answer them, or you can also grab me outside later. Thank you.
Hello. Anyone who wants to ask a question can come down here.
So, from your talk, what I can see is your whole work is 95% science, 95% art, and then 10% bring them together. Now, how do you do all this? Like, as in the amount of in our engineering, we do machine learning, we use fuzzy logic, but then we just stop there. We don't go beyond to animation and music and stuff like that. So taking that, putting it into music, that seems like a really challenging task. And then after that, being up to date in technology, because technology moves forward every day, being up to date in technology, that's another difficult task. How do you make all that happen?
Hello. Oh, there it is. We're having some problems with the audio, apparently. I agree, yes. And the latter part of the talk, which I just went too slow, I kind of addressed that a little bit. And what it is that when you're using, say, fuzzy logic to drive music, right, you're losing a component. Like, if I just wrote a piece of music and played it for you, it would be a piece of music, and it would be as beautiful as I wrote, and that's it, right? If I'm breaking it apart into pieces as I'm using fuzzy logic to put it back together, I'm losing a component of the beauty of that music because it's being filtered. I'm like running it through this new system. However, this new system also gives me the power to do something new and interesting. And if I understand what I did making the music in the first place, the choices in my brain that I go like, oh, I'm going to take this theme and I'm going to put that motif, and I take that expertise, it's why it's called the expert system, you put that expertise into the AI that you're designing with the expert system, and usually what I've seen is that you build as many components of that as you can to make something interesting and to achieve the goals you're after, but then there's going to be some errant cases, right? Some cases that don't work, that are errors, and then what you do is you build in other things to catch those errors and eject them, right? And it's the nice thing about art, right? And I'm sure your robotics team probably sees the same thing, right? You design for all the cases you want, but then you've got some bad case you don't like, and you design something to catch it and throw it out, right? That's one way to think about it. Expert systems are great that way, but it really is, you lose something by moving to the AI, but you also gain something that's kind of a new art. And in the case of, say, Lord of the Rings, you gain, you know, 10,000 agents running around, you know, that you, it would be really hard to do by hand, right? The other thing to think about with machine learning that I think is really interesting is machine learning is really good at picking up on the really fine, complex data, right, that goes with, say, an expressive form. However, it's really hard to parameterize, so an artist can do that latter part where you add something in. And it's an interesting thing I think in the future we'll see with art mixing with machine learning is how to add the artist part back in because the parameters going into a machine, you know, a deep net is really hard. You know, you train it and then you sort of have your system. I'm sure some of you guys understand way better than I do, but hopefully that answered your question.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah.
Hello, sir. I'm a big movie buff, so I want to ask you about motion capture. Of course, you know Mr. Andy Serkis. He's a great motion capture artist. So he's played like he's everywhere in the motion capture. He's in the, of course, played the Gollum, and he's in the Star Wars. He's in the Rise of the Planet of the Apes. So apart from the really wide range of the characters that he's played, what's your favorite one?
Oh, well, you know, Gollum's my favorite, of course, in Lord of the Rings. Like, Gollum's amazing. I'm biased because I have friends who are very much involved in that, but it's also the first. It's the first really believable CG character, I think, in a live-action film. So, yeah, but he's amazing. And the Planet of the Apes stuff is great. Like, the motion capture, again, it's that the ability to communicate that fine detail and the expressiveness of the performance through the filter of all the processing is really impressive where they've gotten with that. And you'll see, if you look at the Unreal Engine work with Ninja Theory, I think it is, they just did a thing where there's facial capture and it's all real time. And that's incredible, like where they can actually perform it and watch it and it looks completely real and believable. And they're using tens of thousands of polys and full physics simulations and whatnot for hair and cloth and that kind of thing is impressive where they're going with that. Do you have a question?
Hey, Mike, it's really great to have you out here. I'm a really big fan of your games and all your movies. But then, what do you think is your favorite part? Is it the movies, is it the games, or what is it?
People always go, what do you get bored? Like, is that why you shift from thing to thing? And what I really suffer from is I get interested too easily in things. And so right now, I just did a big project that will be out soon and involved a big full orchestra at Sky Sound, and that I really enjoy doing that. I don't do it as often as I would probably like, but when I do it, I really, really enjoy it. I like film. I like all of it, to be totally honest. I think I like the project that I have going on that I can't talk about, but I wouldn't mind working in film again at some point.
So what's the next thing we gamers should look forward to?
yeah,
exactly.
If I knew, I would tell you. No, I wouldn't. I wouldn't.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you.
Is that it?
That's all.
Okay. Thank you all.